Hi folks, Dr. Chapman here. Today we'll learn about the geology of Denali National Park, the concept of isostasy, and what makes Denali so high. Denali, at 6,190 meters, is the highest mountain in North America. Globally, there are hundreds of peaks that reach higher elevations, chiefly in the Himalayas and Andes, but Denali may have the greatest topographic relief in the world. Topographic relief is how far above the surrounding terrain the mountain rises.
Rise up to the earth!
The vertical distance from the base to the top of Denali is around 5,600 meters. For comparison, the topographic relief of Mount Everest is around 4,700 meters. If we include mountains with their bases below sea level, Mauna Kea on the Big Island of Hawaii is the tallest mountain on Earth, with over 10,000 meters of relief from the seafloor to the summit. It's hard for mountains to reach such high elevations because gravity is working to pull them down. Ain't no mountain high enough. Part of the reason Mauna Kea was able to become so tall is that most of the mountain is surrounded by water instead of air, and the pressure from the water pushing in on the sides of the mountain helped keep it from collapsing. Likewise, scientists have suggested that lower gravity on other planets and asteroids may allow mountains to reach even greater heights. The two tallest in the solar system are Olympus Mons on Mars and a peak on the asteroid Vesta, both of which are about 26 kilometers high. Back on Earth, geoscientists have suggested that because of gravity, it may be impossible.
Nothing's impossible.
For mountains to ever grow to elevations much higher than Mount Everest, more than 9 kilometers or so. For very high mountain ranges, there's a delicate balance between the force of gravity pulling the mountain down and the tectonic forces pushing the mountain up. Near the summit of Mount Everest, there are actually normal faults or extensional faults. These are the type of faults formed when Earth's crust is being pulled apart or collapsing from gravity. Extensional faults are also responsible for creating the lowest elevation in North America, the Badwater Basin in Death Valley National Park, which is 86 meters below sea level. Of course, there are lower points in the oceans, the deepest being the Mariana Trench in the Pacific Ocean that is more than 11 kilometers below sea level. If we plot all of the elevations and depths on Earth, we can see these have a bimodal distribution, meaning that the data clusters into two peaks on the plot. These peaks are the average elevation of the oceans and continents. The reason we have this bimodal distribution is because the oceanic crust and continental crust are different thicknesses and because they are made of different types of rocks with different densities. Density and thickness are the two main controls on isostasy. Isostasy describes how buoyant the crust is with respect to the mantle. Another way of saying this is how high the crust floats within the mantle.
It feels like I'm floating.
You may have heard that the majority of an iceberg is actually submerged beneath the water. This is because ice is only a little less dense than water, so only a little bit floats above the surface. If we put a block of wood in water, it floats higher than ice because it's less dense than ice, and the density difference between the wood and the water is greater than the density difference between ice and water.
Are you both seriously this dense?
Oceanic crust is made of more dense rock than continental crust, and it floats lower in the mantle. Oceanic crust also floats lower in the mantle because it is much thinner than continental crust. If we want a really tall iceberg, we need a really thick column of ice. And because only a small percentage of the iceberg sticks out above the water, we need to add a lot of thickness to get just a little bit more elevation. Mountain ranges work much the same way. To create a mountain range 2 kilometers high, like the average elevation of the Alaska Range, where Denali National Park is, we need to make the crust about 15 kilometers thicker than normal.
Real thick.
This extra thickness is largely hidden beneath the Earth's surface, like an iceberg, and it's called a mountain root or crustal root. If you look at a map that geophysicists created showing the thickness of the crust in Alaska, you can see the crust beneath the Alaska Range and Denali is much thicker than elsewhere in the state. There's also an area of thick crust in northern Alaska. That's the Brooks Range. Almost everywhere you go on Earth, where there are mountains, there is also thicker than average crust.
To climbing mountains.
Which is around 35 kilometers. Because of isostasy, it takes a lot of work, a lot of crustal thickening to make mountains. You can't just make a pile of rock 6 kilometers high to make a 6 kilometer high mountain like Denali. The high elevation of Denali and the Alaska Range was produced by crustal thickening in a restraining bend in the Denali strike slip fault. Strike slip faults often have curves or bends in them. When a strike slip fault curves across the direction of motion, it's called a restraining bend, and it results in compressional stresses and contractional faulting like reverse faults. When a strike slip fault curves away from the direction of motion, it's called a releasing bend. These areas develop extensional stresses and normal faults as the crust is pulled apart and a hole or a basin is formed that can fill with sediment. The Denali Fault curves across the direction of motion and is a restraining bend, so it's an area of contraction and thickening. The last major earthquake on the Denali Fault.
What is it, boy? Fire? Earthquake? Hippie?
A magnitude 7.9 earthquake in 2002 started on a thrust fault in the restraining bend before branching out to the main strike slip part of the fault. Movement on similar thrust faults helped to thicken the crust and increase the elevation of Denali. Geologists estimate that Denali has increased in elevation by about 3 kilometers in the last 6 million years. Of course, Denali is eroding at the same time. It is rising, and the total amount of rock uplift in that 6 million year period is around 10 kilometers.
Data inaccurate, does not compute.
It's a hard concept to wrap your head around, but rock uplift is not the same thing as surface uplift. Erosion can be slower or faster than rock uplift, meaning Earth's surface may be gaining or losing elevation over geologic time. The movement of rocks relative to Earth's surface is called exhumation. In the case of Denali, the rocks have exhumed about 7 kilometers in the last 6 million years, which is the amount of rock uplift minus the increase in elevation. So what changed 6 million years ago that caused Denali to start to rapidly uplift? The collision of the Yakutat Microplate with southern Alaska.
Yakutat!
The Denali Fault is a major strike slip fault, but is not a plate boundary like the San Andreas Fault. The Denali Fault occurs within the North American Plate. The boundary between the North American Plate and the Pacific Plate is located almost 500 kilometers to the south of Denali National Park. The Pacific Plate subducts beneath southwestern Alaska and slides along the Queen Charlotte Fairweather Strike Slip Fault in southeast Alaska. The Yakutat Microplate was carried along with the Pacific Plate and is now being jammed into the corner of south central Alaska. The Yakutat Microplate is an oceanic plateau and is about 30 kilometers thick, around 5 times thicker than normal oceanic crust. Because of isostasy, this extra thickness makes the Yakutat Microplate much more buoyant, and it floats much higher in the mantle, more like continental crust. The extra buoyancy also means that it resists subduction, like continental crust. The Yakutat Microplate is partly subducting and partly accreting and colliding with North America. The part that's subducting subducts at a very low angle, as it resists sinking because of its buoyancy. The low angle causes the Yakutat slab to scrape against the base of the Alaskan lithosphere, which geoscientists often call increased plate coupling.
We're not a couple. We're definitely not a couple.
All this scraping and colliding is pushing southern Alaska along the Denali Fault and other faults, resulting in counterclockwise rotation of the crust. At the apex of this rotation and the curve in the Denali Fault is the Alaska Range and Denali National Park. So what makes Denali so high? It's isostasy. The high elevation is isostatically supported by thick crust, and the crust is thick because of a restraining bend in the Denali Fault, and the Denali Fault is especially active and curved because the Yakutat Microplate is colliding with southern Alaska and pushing the crust out of the way. And the Yakutat Microplate is colliding because it is anomalously thick and buoyant and doesn't want to subduct. And the reason it's buoyant is because of isostasy. Hey, thanks for watching. Check out some more videos and share them with friends and family. Take care.